Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome. My name is Lane Lawrenson. I am Jordan's cousin and have been asked to serve as Master of Ceremonies for this afternoon's proceedings, which will feature a series of speakers expressing their thoughts and remembrances of Zxayven Ice Pelech. I would ask that everyone who has not, please turn off the ringers on your cell phones at this time. On behalf of Zxayven's family, I want to thank you all for joining us today as we celebrate and honor an incredible young man. Thank you for joining us as we grieve. Thank you for supporting us as we move forward. And most especially, thank you for having been a part of Zxayven's village. We were all blessed to have known Zxayven, even though it was for much too short of a time. When Zxayven's family asked about booking the Allied Arts Center, Don Conrad told them it was available, but that the set from Zxayven's final play was still on the stage and they would have it cleaned up by today. Immediately, they knew that the set should stay, the tables should be set up just like a dinner theater, and we should pay tribute to an incredible young man in an environment that he loved. I will now call on Reverend Bill Doyle to lead our land acknowledgement.
We begin our time together by acknowledging the traditional territory on which we gather as a small step towards reconciliation with our First Nations brothers and sisters. We gather on the original lands of the Plain Cree, those of Treaty 6 and the homeland of the Métis Nation. And in doing so, we also acknowledge with respect the history, the spirituality, and the culture of the peoples with whom Treaty 6 was signed, and our responsibility as treaty members to honor the heritage and the gifts of the First Nations peoples of this region, and to walk gently on this land.
Thank you, Reverend. Now, our first speaker was to be Laura McCormack. I understand she is sick today, but I have a copy of some of what she was going to say, so I'll read it now. Hi, my name is Laura McCormack. I'm a friend of Kyle and Jordan's. I met them when I was living in Paradise Valley. I got to have the pleasure of meeting Zxayven when he was first born. 3 days we were in that hospital in Lloydminster waiting for him to arrive. That little man came into this world a fighter. What a bundle of joy he was, such a happy little boy. When we lived in Paradise Valley and Zxayven was just a baby, I would take him to my home and he used to sleep in my dresser drawer by my bed. He looked like an angel, a little cherub, and I affectionately nicknamed him my little Chub Chub. I used to come to Elk Point regularly to visit Zxayven. I would take him for Chinese food and then get him a gift from Renita's. He was always so full of life, I loved his energy. I enjoyed when Kyle and Jordan used to come visit us. My kids were much older, so he was such a joy to entertain and play with. I enjoyed our times visiting at their family lake lot and making gifts for Kyle and Jordan. I never really got to know Zxayven as a teenager, but kept track of him throughout the years and the many pictures Jordan posted on Facebook. Just recently, Jordan and I got together at Halloween, and she couldn't wait to show me pictures of the handsome man he had become. She was so proud of him, and I know he was loved so much. His memory will forever be in our hearts, and he will be missed. I never thought I would be up here today speaking about Zxayven, but if I can send a message to you all now is if you, sorry about that. You are enough. Be kind to everyone and hold on for tomorrow because it is going to be a better day. Now it's from Laura McCormick. I would now like to invite two of Ryan's friends to come forward and speak, Ryan Urquhart and Lauren Smith, who will share some remembrances of him.
Zxayven was an amazing friend. I'll miss the days where we used to hang out during elementary and the theater rehearsals after school. I'll miss times that I had laughing at his jokes and funny antics. But out of everything, I'm going to miss his overall presence the most.
Zxayven was a really good friend to me, and he was, at times, pretty much the only friend I had in my class. We spent pretty much all of school constantly talking to each other, or at least nearby, and he was pretty much the only person I talked to in school half the time. I'm gonna miss having him around to talk to and share random, useless information with, question why he knew some weird things. I have a thing that Josh asked me to say since he's not talking. Josh wanted to say that he was a great friend. He always had a smile on his face. He was a kind guy, and Josh misses him a lot. Hopes he's living his best life up in heaven.
Thank you, Lauren and Ryan. Our next speaker is Leanne Gilbert. Leanne is one of Jordan and Kyle's close friends, and her children were friends of Zxayven's. I welcome Leanne to come and share her thoughts with us. Following Leanne's words, we'll sing Turn, 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 originally by Pete Seeger. This version is by Northern Skylight and is based on text found in the book Ecclesiastes. Leanne.
I wrote this poem for Zxayven on what effects bullying can have on a kind soul. I knew this boy from the minute he was born up to his last days. He was my teddy bear. The poem is called The Teddy Bear's Heart. At school, I just wanted a little acceptance. I wanted to see what being 15 was about. Because of maybe my size, I was left out. No room for me, just doubt. My teddy bear heart is starting to change. I do have a few nice friends that are a big deal. However, there are some that are fake and just not real. It started with one bully, then there were two. When you watch this, what did you do? Oh no, my heart cracked. It's now into two. The laughter and the fun in the hallways with friends are so great. I could see this and hear this, but I did not hate. The heads down and the lookaways, as they walked by, I heard they had lots to say. All these people around me, yet I'm so alone. Get me out of here. I'm hurt, I'm sick, I have to go home. My teddy bear heart is changing more. It used to be full of beautiful colors and soar. Words I heard coming from the people I see was just let him be. Let him be? Leave me alone? What's happening to me? Oh no, it cracked. It's now into three. Someone just pushed me and called me a bad name. As I've been told time again, you can't but hit back. That would be a shame. You're much bigger than them. These are the policies. This is the game. Go home and have a nice day. My teddy bear heart has now changed. Why haven't you seen? Remember, I was only 15. This teddy bear heart has nothing left. I'm not a fighter, so now I can rest. I love you, Zxayven. Rest in peace, teddy bear.
Don Conrad will now come forward. Don has been involved in the Elk Point Theater Company for many years, decades even. So of course, he and Zxayven connected during their latest production, which was Zxayven's last performance. The family would also like to extend a heartfelt thank you to Dawn for readying the hall and providing volunteers for Zxayven's celebration of life. Dawn?
On behalf of the cast and crew of Dinner Theater 2021, I extend our deepest sympathy to Zxayven's family and all his friends. I really didn't know Zxayven as a young boy growing up through the school system, because when he started school, I was retiring. But I have been a part of him through the Performing Arts Society in the community. I was able to watch him grow up and develop his talents and his love for the theater as he was part of the Theater Project, which is a youth group. As I watched his performances, I had a hopeful eye that he would someday join the senior drama group. This year, our show required a younger boy, and when I read the script, I knew who it was going to be. It was going to be Zxayven. Well, most people at that time, he was 14, most people at the age of 14, having to interact with 15 people much more their senior would be a bit of an uncomfortable situation, but not for Zxayven. He fit right in. As time went on, we saw his versatility, his talents, and most of all, his enjoyment for being a part of us. And he became our youngest star. As a director of the show, I envisioned great things for him, and this was just the beginning. However, things stopped short of that. But I believe that although he will not be performing with us here on this stage, he will continue to be performing on a more grand stage, at a place where no one is judgmental, at a place where there are no critics, at a place where there is no bullying, at a place where you can be comfortably just yourself and who you are. The cast and crew of the Dinner Theater truly enjoyed having Zxayven as our young star. So, even though it was a very short period of time. So now, when we look up to the heavenly sky and see a star twinkling up there, we know that is our Zxayven. Rest in peace. You will be missed.
Thank you, Dawn. I'd now like to invite a longtime friend of the Pelech Milholland family to the microphone, Vicki Brooker. Please come forward and say a few words about Zxayven.
This is way beyond my comfort zone, but here you go. I've known Zxayven since he was just a baby. I made him a quilt when he was born. But later on, he took to the theater, and his grandma said, "Well, you know how to sew. You can make costumes." Well, I have made a number of those over time, but the The last one I made was certainly the most interesting. I had never before made a costume that had to be rent apart and put back together immediately for the next performance. But this was a special kind of play, and I have always been a great fan of Monty Python. So when I was called to make a shirt that could be repaired immediately, I took it as an interesting challenge. And there he was, on stage in this shirt, saying, "I am Lancelot, I'm big and strong and hot." And he ripped the shirt open and had the most amazing t-shirt under it with muscles and all that. And everybody roared. He was a fine performer, and that was one of his finest performances. Thank you.
Thank you, Vicky. Zxayven was well known for his appearances on the stage. He'd been involved with the theater since third grade, and we'd be delighted if you joined in the singing of the song that started it all for him. The song Zxayven as Sebastian sang in The Little Mermaid. Jordan's sister, Jayme, and her husband, Mark, will now share some special memories and thoughts.
Once a gentle giant walked among us, and we are blessed. Zxayven's life was too short, but his impact will continue to ripple through our lives. Today, I would like to share three things about Zxayven that I hold in my heart. And as we take one step in front of the other, I ask you to take these with you and make a difference. The first is dragons. Zxayven loved to read, and one of his favorites was the book series Wings of Fire. These fantasy stories involve dragons struggling with very human issues. I haven't read these books myself, but when I think of dragons, mythological creatures who are fierce protectors come to mind. Zxayven was a dragon, a fierce protector. We need to be fierce protectors too. The second is the pool. When Zxayven was younger, he would visit us and we spent a lot of time at the swimming pool. A number of summers, he stayed with us to take swimming lessons with his cousin, Avery. Although he learned how to swim, he really just loved being in the water. Bobbing and floating in the water changed him. There was peace as he moved through the water. I saw that same buoyancy later when he was in the pool at the cabin. As you know, in water, your movements need to be slow and deliberate, requiring calm and focus from your core. I think for Zxayven, being in the water allowed him to find calm and helped him find his center. We need to find that buoyancy too. The third is Caesar salad. You may not know it, but Zxayven was a picky eater. One of his favorites was Caesar salad, a simple side dish of romaine lettuce, croutons, and dressing. A family meal wasn't complete without Caesar salad. As it was passed around, Zxayven would make sure everyone had some, and there was always enough. At the end of the meal, Zxayven would ask if anyone else wanted more salad before diving in to finish it off. He understood abundance and enjoyed the simple things in life. We need to live out of abundance and enjoy the simple things too. So, as we take one step in front of the other, as we eat Caesar salad, go to the pool and find dragons, may we be the change. Remember to be kind to others, and kind to ourselves, because once a gentle giant walked among us, and we are blessed.
Zxayven had the most open-hearted view of people. He was so lovely to be around because he didn't hold judgment about others, didn't criticize their choices or who they were. I was always amazed at the people he knew and who he connected with. But I guess that's not surprising. As it's so rare to meet someone who just accepts you as you are. And because of that, he gathered the most interesting and amazing people into his village. If we can learn anything from Zxayven, it would be this. Hold back your judgment. Examine your prejudices. And tackle the limitations that keep you from seeing someone's humanity. Keep you from connecting deeply, truly with others. Look for the humanity in others. Look for the good. Look beyond appearances and into the heart and connect. 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 And then connect some more. Zxayven also had a very direct way of looking at the world. He preferred all things to be precise and clear. It's true, perhaps, that many nuances escaped him, but it's also true that he saw through bluster and obfuscation to the heart of a situation and a person. He was a young man of very few words, but he noticed everything. He felt everything. I think it would be very difficult to operate in society where there is so much noise, so much gray area, and so many unanswerable questions. But I'd like us to learn from Zxayven, to care for tender hearts, to communicate clearly and compassionately, to be honest about what we need, and to be purposeful in our support of others. If there is anything good to come out of this tragedy, it is that all of us here today can make a commitment to go forward with gentleness, with attention to the needs of others, and to create a butterfly effect of kindness and connection. And finally, Zxayven had the most incredible memory, which came in handy when he had lines to remember. But he also stored the most interesting facts about a diverse and random range of topics. I just never knew what was going to capture his interest. But no matter what he told me about, I learned never to question it. He was always accurate, always right. Except in one heartbreaking instance. He came to believe that there was no place for him here, that the world would be better without his light, in that he was flat out wrong. And I will miss him so, so much.
Thank you, Jayme and Mark. Doris Pinrock has known Zxayven since he was in elementary school. He was part of a volunteer team that Doris coordinated, and we would like to welcome her to say a few words next.
For those of you who don't know me, I am with Victim Services. But before, I used to work at Elk Point Elementary as an educational assistant and as a wellness facilitator. This is where I got to know Zxayven. He was a cute, gentle giant from the time he started school. I always thought of him as an old soul, Often he would get jokes that most children wouldn't. And he was a fountain of knowledge in many areas advanced for his years. And there was times he would work at his desk and mutter under his breath like a little old man. A prized memory of Zxayven was the way he would often answer questions. He'd take a deep breath, lean forward, and clasp his hands, and begin with, "Well." Now, it could either be followed by him debating both points of a possible answer. He made it like he was telling a story or imparting some sort of wisdom, which sometimes he was. Then there were times where he would take a deep breath, lean forward, clasp his hands, and say, "Well," and give the briefest one-word answer. When Zxayven was in grade 4, he joined the Elk Point Elementary School Ambassadors Program. This was a new program at the time where grade 4, 5, and 6 students volunteered in the school and in the community, as well as monthly visits to the residents of Heritage Lodge or Parkview Extended Care. I was the co-founder and leader of this program. This is where I got to spend more time with Zxayven and learn more about him. Zxayven was one of the first students to sign up and one of only two from his class to participate for the full 3 years. He was an excellent school ambassador, always eager to sign up for delegations and never complained about doing what was asked or required of him. However, I think he preferred entertaining the residents of Heritage or Parkview, or maybe it was making mini donuts or cotton candy on extravaganza, because it was fun to do the quality control and sample the goods. I often told parents and staff I was the luckiest employee at EPE because I got to spend time with my ambassadors outside of a classroom. Often on our walks to events or down time at events, we would talk and laugh, always having fun. And it was at one of these times Zxayven talked about his puppy, Leonard. After that, he was always eager to talk about him. And one day we were walking back from our visit to Heritage, and lo and behold, when we got by the public library, there was Grandma Sherry with Leonard. We were all excited to see that oh-so-adorable fluffy puppy, Leonard. And he was equally excited to see us, but most of all, he was excited to see Zxayven. For 3 years, Zxayven was a big part of the ambassador program. It was a sad, tearful day when at our year-end wind-up party that we said goodbye to Zxayven. Respectfully, optimistically, attitude always positive, as well as responsible, was Zxayven. Sometimes in the program, I wasn't always sure what I was doing, but he followed, believing and having faith. And how could I or this program fail with such dedication? I said it then, and I say it now. It was an honor working with you and a pleasure getting to know you, Zxayven. It was hard to say goodbye then, and it's so hard to say goodbye now. I will miss you.
Thank you, Doris. I'd now like to invite Reverend Bill Doyle to share a message. Zxayven's family would like to thank him for traveling all the way from Spruce Grove today to be with us.
Because I'm a minister in Spruce Grove, I never had the opportunity to meet Zxayven. But I had a short conversation with Jayme earlier this week. And from that conversation, I have to admit I was intrigued. I was intrigued by what shone through as Zxayven's energy and what I would call his presence. And I was intrigued by what was described to me as his interests and his gifts. And so I came here this afternoon anticipating that I would hear so much about him this afternoon, and in that way get to know him a lot better. And I haven't been disappointed, of course. One of the readings that you'll often hear at a celebration of life is from the Old Testament book of Ecclesiastes. You'll recognize the words from the song of Pete Seeger that you heard this afternoon. Ecclesiastes is one of the few books of wisdom literature in the Bible. Generally speaking, it includes insights about life. Reading selected verses, "For everything there is a season, and a time for every matter under heaven. A time to be born and a time to die, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance. I know that whatever God does endures forever." You'll have noted the collection of opposites in the first line. For everything there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven. A time to be born and a time to die. And those opposites are followed by other pairings. Weeping and laughing, mourning and dancing. All of those pairings cause us to reflect on the ups and the downs of life, to reflect on each of those human experiences and how far apart they are and how close together they are. Think of the expression, "I laughed so hard that I cried," or the need to tell a joke to relieve one's discomfort or pain or anxiety. Think about how with each deep relationship there comes an inevitable loss, perhaps at a time just like this. This interplay of life and death and weeping and laughing and mourning and dancing is a given in the world in which we live. We move from place to place, often moving to new life, but at the same time leaving old friends behind. Aging brings maturity, but it also brings aches and pains that weren't there yesterday. An awareness of death comes with an appreciation for life, which enables us all to live life to the fullest. At times like this, we have to acknowledge the sense of loss and the sense of pain. But at times like this, we also need to focus on the many joys that have come from the lives that we've shared with Zxayven and all of the things that he leaves behind. When you think about it, each of us is a collection of opposites, a collection of things that are more often called contradictions. And Zxayven is an example of that. We think of Zxayven's tremendous spirit, and we know that Zxayven leaves behind his spirit, which will strengthen us and enable us to handle all that we'll face. We think of Zxayven's memory for facts, and we know that Zxayven leaves behind the memories that we have of him, memories that will serve to comfort us when we need comfort. We think of Zxayven's big, big heart, and we know that Zxayven leaves behind close family ties and some good, good friends, all of whom will reach out to us and be there for us when we need it. We think of Zxayven's sensitivity and know that Zxayven leaves behind a modeling of the need to care for and comfort those around us. Because of all that Zxayven leaves behind, we will always feel that Zxayven is with us, listening to us and caring for us and loving us as the heart which is at the center of all of us. Know that Zxayven will continue to be with us all in this way. Amen.
Billy Milholland is Sherry's sister and Zxayven's great aunt. She will now share a few words with everyone.
In the family thing of things, scene of things, Zxayven was my great nephew. I was his great aunt. He was also my grand nephew. I'm not so sure how grand an aunt I was, but he was certainly my grand nephew. There was never a time that I would see him, think about him, hear him speak when I had to smile. It was impossible not to smile when you were around Zxayven, and I can see by the people that are here and by the words that have been spoken, we all agree that this must stop. This kind of thing that drives a person like him to do what he did, it's not acceptable. And it's not like we didn't try to make a difference. I know we did. All of us, all the schools have anti-bullying policies. We wear pink shirts. We dye our hair pinks. We shave our heads. We attend rallies and workshops. We declare anti-bullying days, weeks, months. We teach kids to recite positive affirmations. But it turns out making this stop is not as easy as we thought. And it's funny, you know, we would never suggest that we could learn math overnight. We know it's not a skill that we can learn in an hour or a couple of days in a year. We know that math is complex. So is the issue of bullying. It's much more complex than we knew when about a decade ago, anti-bullying programs started to become common in schools, in companies, sometimes even on sports teams. But I think at that time, we started out with the naive notion that all we had to do was name it. And there's really nothing wrong that we did over the last decade, but it was just a start, and I think it was a naive start. No matter what age it happens, bullying is a power struggle. It's difficult for anyone at any age to resolve this. It's especially difficult for children to resolve it without adult help. And how do we help? We all do the best we can, but a lot of times we don't have all the knowledge we need. When I was a kid, and I hear this a lot, people say to me, when I was a kid, this and this and this happened, and we turned out okay. Well, some of us didn't turn out okay, but that's not the point. Things have changed, and they've changed again, and we still resort to the same kind of responses. When I was a kid, when the boys yanked a girl's pants down in the schoolyard, we were told, boys will be boys. And when a group of girls taunted another girl and would say, nobody likes you, everybody thinks you're stupid, we were told, oh, they were just teasing. They were joking. They were just fooling around. Those threats weren't real. They didn't mean it. And best of all, most often, those being bullied, when they spoke up, they were told not to tattle. When my kids were in school, I still heard those phrases, and my grandkids still hear those phrases at school. We're operating on old information, and we've got to upgrade. My grandkids' generation have the added terror of cyberbullying, something I didn't experience. Probably most of you here didn't either. Because we could run home, shut the door, and we were safe. When our kids now go home, they're not safe. If they have a phone, someone can text them. If they're on the computer, there's so many ways that people can reach them. And saying to take away their devices would be a solution. In this day and age, our kids want exactly what we want. They want to belong. And they live in a computer age. That kind of interaction is going to be the way they need to learn. And it is not safe for them. And I don't know how we make it safe, but we need to think about it and find out how. We're a smart species. There's a lot of things we can do. Not all our strategies in the past have been helpful, but together we can. Am I dead? Nope. I guess other people have said it too. Whatever happens, it has to be together. We can't expect schools, governments, companies to figure this out for us. We have to help, or we have to do it. We have to chat with each other. We have to be able to say some of the things that are difficult to say. Sometimes even bullies don't know that they're bullies. We have to find ways to tell them. We have to find ways to listen better. When kids are being bullied, it might seem trivial to us. It's not trivial to them. They want to belong. And when bullies are letting them know that they don't belong, we can't logic that away. We have to listen, and we have to speak with each other, and we have to listen to each other. We all have different ideas on how this will come down. And one of the reasons that Sherry asked me to speak about this is because I belong to a small group in Edmonton, a small group of old bats like me. We all have grandkids, and we all realize that what's been done in the past has been, like, okay, we need a boost to this. I don't know what we're going to be able to do to boost it, but we've been, for a couple of months, we've been researching, finding out what's going on in the world. There's a lot of things going on in the world, a lot of new things, a lot of good things, a lot of silly things. We're trying to weed out what's better than something else. And so far, we've gathered about, maybe 6-8 pages of resources. I'm not sure what we'll do with them. We're sharing them with other old bats like ourselves who want to help to make the world safer for our grandkids. So at some point, if any of you want to leave me your email address or give it to Sherry. As we gather these resources, we'd be happy to send them on. I don't know what kind of difference that will make, but we felt before this we have to do something. We feel even 100 times stronger now that we can't just sit there and hope. And I hope you'll help.
Thank you, Billy. Zxayven was part of a multi-generational household and has lived with his grandparents since he was an infant. His shared passion for reading and baking, among many other things with his grandma, he shared a passion for reading and baking, among other things, with his grandma. And his grandma, Sherry, will now share a few memories and words with you.
The end of September 2006, the hospital in Lloydminster was experiencing a birthing boom. All the obstetric beds were full, and this is why our beautiful grandson was born in the early morning of the 25th in a linen closet. When I first laid eyes on Zxayven, I was gobsmacked, besotted, completely in love. On the early morning of December 8th, all the light and joy and color left my world. But oh, what a glorious ride those 15 years were. They were filled with love, adventure, exasperation, pride, worry, joy, and so, so much laughter. Zxayven was a boy of few words, and he really didn't talk until age 4, the same age he learned to read. I was amazed as he read to me The Gruffalo, and I said, "You memorized that whole book." He gave me that patient look. "No, Grandma, I'm reading it." And he was. And he never looked back after that. From then on, he read at least one book a week and more. He grew to be a very big and tall boy with exceptional strength. His bear hugs could crush you. But he was always gentle. Except the day he took out a full-grown kindergarten teacher. You see, Zxayven often got overwhelmed by too much sound or light or chaos. When he did, he just left the room. One day, he was in flight mode, and his kindergarten teacher foolishly blocked the doorway. She never even slowed him down. And Zxayven loved to cook, starting at a very early age. We bought him his very own tiny cast iron frying pan for his 4th birthday. He would sit on the counter by the stove and make Sunday morning pancakes with his gyro. And later, his specialties were that hamburger macaroni thing, monster cookies, and chicken cordon bleu. He baked cupcakes and Danish pastries for his class sometimes. But he still loved his Rice Krispies and Mr. Noodle. Mr. Nunu was what he called it when he was little, and we still call it that. He loved camping, fishing, swimming, and traveling. He was wise, philosophical, always older than his years, and very funny. With his quirky sense of humor and the oddball way he looked at the world. Zxayven had an extensive vocabulary and was always happy to add new words to his repertoire. When he was in grade 5, he broke his collarbone on a skiing field trip. While he was being strapped up, he was delighted to learn that the collarbone is also called a clavicle. He told me several times then, this, the collarbone is a clavicle. It is a clavicle. When he got to return to his classroom, he told his startled teacher that he had broken his sphincter. At age 6, he had open heart surgery to repair a hole in his heart. It was patched with a piece of bovine heart. We always told him he had the heart of a bull, and he did. He had the biggest heart, always caring for the smaller ones, which was pretty much everyone. And he loved his animals. When he was 5, he went to a Halloween party at the Allied Arts Building. He went as a vampirate, full pirate gear with vampire teeth. He came home with a tiny all-black kitten. He said people were being mean to it and he had to save it. He named it Velcro because it was soft as velvet, black as a crow, and clung to him like a burr. At age 10, we took him to a farm to pick out his very own puppy. When we arrived, all the little short-haired puppies came tumbling out to meet us. Behind them waddled a fat, furry puffball. Zxayven scooped him up and said he had found his puppy. What should we name him, he asked. Well, we told him it was his puppy. He could name him whatever he wanted. He happily declared, I will name him Night Whisper. No, you won't. You said I could name him whatever I want. Yeah, you can, just not Night Whisper. Humph, he said. Then his name is Leonard. Okay, Leonard it is. 2 years ago, Zxayven smuggled a little black kitten with a white-tipped tail into the house. He said he had to because they were being mean to it. He was named Casey, K-C for kitty cat. Then a year ago, his beloved Velcro died, and exactly 1 week later, the dogs brought home a tiny all-black kitten that needed a lot of expensive TLC with vet visits and special foods. He named her Texas. So along with a cat he rescued from the dump that he named Merlin Monroe and a black marama pup called Miss Gigi, Zxayven was surrounded by his animals. But more than anything, Zxayven loved the stage. From his very first role as Sebastian in The Little Mermaid when he was 8 to his most recent role as Paul, a goth teenager with blue hair, he played his parts with a professionalism that far outstripped his young age. He easily memorized his lines and most of everyone else's. A few years ago, when he was being congratulated for his performance in one of his plays, he was asked, are you going to be an actor? Without hesitation, he replied, I am an actor. Zxayven was a giant in many ways and leaves the biggest hole that can never be filled. I would say, hey, tall person, whenever I needed something from a top shelf. He would try to hide his smile and roll his eyes and reach for what I needed. But he built me a two-step step stool so that I will always be able to reach. And with his Gido, he cut, split, and stacked huge piles of wood with hardly breaking a sweat. Need help moving furniture? He was your guy. Shoveling snow, toting, lifting, carrying, just call. Always helpful, always ready to volunteer. Every day, I am missing tripping over his size 15 boots. So, in memory of our gentle giant, please, please be kind to each other. Tell people you love them and make sure they know just how much they are appreciated and needed and how necessary they are. Be at peace, my beautiful, beautiful boy.
Thank you, Sherry. I now have an email to read out that was sent from Francois Nadeau and his wife, Alexa Petroski. They've been friends and lake neighbors of the Milholland Pelech families for more than 50 years. They sincerely wanted to be here today, but circumstances wouldn't allow them. They adored Zxayven, and Francois wanted to share a few special memories. I'll read their letter for you now. Dear family and friends of Zxayven, my first recollection of Zxayven is of the moment I heard his name, followed by his no less startling given middle name and crowned by the acronym ZIP. Zxayven stood out even before I laid eyes on this giggling baby of 8 months in the early summer of 2007 at Muriel Lake. In my mind's eye, there are still two vivid episodes from the young life of Mr. Z, as I would come to call him, affectionately. He would have been going on 4 in that summer of 2010. Little Mr. Z was supervising the work I was doing near our cabin at the lake when I bent down. Zxayven asked what was wrong, to which I explained that I had lost my breath. When I looked up again, Zxayven had disappeared, so I started looking for him. I ran into Marshel coming up from the beach. He was still giggling. He had just seen Zxayven looking for something on the beach. What are you looking for? Guido had asked his grandson. Foi foi, that's Francois to a 4-year-old, lost his breath, so I'm out here looking for it. A little later that same summer, we walked into our cabin in the early afternoon carrying a backpack. His head seriously bent downward, looking dejected like someone leaving home. What's with you, young man? My wife Alexa asked him. Zxayven looked up at Alexa. I have issues, and he let out a sigh. Something had obviously been said at the cabin next door. The summers and years went by, and he joined all of us around the table at his grandparents' cabin for a game of 65. Mr. Z even won the first game he played, the score sheet of which was framed and hung on the wall. These last two summers, giving his interest for gastronomy, he had started cooking and he delighted us with outdoor dinners. But Zxayven, for too long of a time you suffered, young man. Suffered much, too much. And this has to be acknowledged. Your memory will nevertheless continue to bring a smile to my days, to our days. From Fua Fua and all of us next door. We'll now watch a video tribute for Zxayven, followed by a prayer read by Reverend Bill Doyle.
Hello. These are my new glasses. All you have to do is wind them up.
You got a friend in me. got a friend in me.
Please join me in prayer. Creator God of love and of life, we give thanks for Zxayven's life, for his love of family and friends, for his love of the theater, for his love of stray animals, for his love of reading, and for his love. We give thanks for the special memories that we each have of Zxayven. May we keep them and him close to our hearts and share them with others in celebration of a life well lived. We give thanks that Zxayven has entered into a new life with you. We rejoice and we celebrate all that he was and all that he is. We can feel his presence with us now, and we can feel his energy and his love and his caring. May we all live as Zxayven did, so that we too may have a rich and a full life. And may we each be accepted just as we are. Compassionate God, nourish us and allow us to drink deeply in your life-giving water of healing and of peace. Especially touch Zxayven's family with your love. May they find comfort and support through the sharing of memories and the sharing of stories. And may they find peace. God of grace, you give us new life and new hope so that we may rejoice in all that Zxayven was and in all that we are. And be with all who feel the loss of Zxayven in their lives. Make them aware of your presence and allow them to know that when they need you, you are there, loving them and caring for them with the power of your spirit. And may the tender love of God, the gentle peace of Christ, and the healing power of the Holy Spirit fill us all deeply and send us out in hope and in joy. Amen. I was also asked to take advantage of this opportunity and share grace with you. Once the celebration of life ends and we have a time of community, we'll no longer easily be able to get your attention. And so you'll each know that when your food is served, you can feel free to enjoy it. Let us pray. Creator God, we have so many things to be thankful for. We thank you for the life that Zxayven lived, the experiences and the memories that we have of him. We thank you for friends and community that will support us and love us. And we thank you for the food that we are about to receive. And we continue to be mindful of all of the hands that have touched and labored so that that food will get to our table. For all of this, we pray. Amen.
In closing, we'd like to thank everyone for coming today, and a special thank you to everyone who prepared for, shared in, and participated in Zxayven's celebration of life. Some of you came today because you knew Zxayven well. Some of you perhaps knew him less well, but felt a connection to him all the same. Some of you may never have even had a long and interesting conversation with Zxayven, but are here out of sorrow and support. Our wish is the same for all of you, to leave this place believing in your worth, trusting in your ability to positively impact those around you, and are inspired to consciously connect with others. Now, in a couple minutes, there will be a bit of lunch served. The meal that we're going to be having is all of Zxayven's favorite foods for you to enjoy. And during lunch, the mic will be open up here for anyone who wishes to come up and share memories or stories about Zxayven. Everyone's welcome to lunch and the microphone. What we'll be doing once dinner is served, we'll be going in through the door right here, and then you can come around and back in the entrance where you came in at earlier. We ask that you please let the family from the reserve tables up front go first and then proceed on your own. Thank you.